Welcome, everyone. We're going to get started. Welcome to the last Log Rocket meetup of the year. We just started doing these a couple months ago. They've been going really well, so we're going to keep doing a lot more, some even bigger ones. If you have any kind of feedback, any topics you want us to cover, any Log Rocket blog posts you want to kind of have someone explore live or in more depth, shoot me an email at luke@logrocket.com. So today we have Brian D'Souza. Is it Sousa or Sousa?
Sousa.
Yeah. Okay. Cool. So yeah, we're going to backstage.io, which is kind of cool. It's a open source. I'll describe it better. Kind of developer portal system built by Spotify. I just spun one up and it was really easy. So yeah. And just like always, we've got more meetups coming. There will be a lot more on this calendar, but the only one scheduled right now is on GraphQL CodeGen. Helps you write GraphQL a lot quicker and test it, do a bunch more stuff. So that's on January 7th for the new year, but there'll be a lot more there. You can sign up from there. And as always, this is brought to you by Log Rocket, and Log Rocket's a front-end monitoring solution. And just for a quick demo, I actually spun up a backstage instance here on local. So we'll obviously go into more depth about what we're looking at here. But yeah, if I go around and like browse and click on stuff and do all that, oops, that went to another part, site, I can go to Log Rocket and see exactly what happened and exactly what I did. So I can go look at this session. It's telling me it's, you know, recorded locally. But I can go play back exactly what I just did. And it just plays back all the React errors. So right now I've got this is a fresh install of Backstage, and I've got a unmounted component error, which is kind of weird. But yeah, you can just see exactly what happened before a bug happened, replay network requests, makes debugging a lot simpler, more easy. So that's all I've got. Brian, you can take it away.
Sounds good. Okay, let me just throw the screen share up here. Oops. Okay, can you see that okay?
No.
No? No. Let me just see what's going on here.
There we go.
Okay, that's better. Okay, so today we're going to do a deep dive on Backstage. So I'm going to talk a little bit about what Backstage is in case you haven't heard of it before. We'll do a quick tour of Backstage, take a look at the features and capabilities that come built into the system out of the box. We'll talk a little bit about the plugin ecosystem and the types of plugins that are available for you to extend your Backstage installation. And then we'll get into a demo of adding a plugin to Backstage. So we're going to add the GitHub pull request plugin to Backstage. We'll go through the steps to add the code and then restart our server and check out what the plugin looks like. And you'll get a sense for how easy it is to extend the system with new plugins. But before we get into that, I'll just say a few words about myself. So I am an application release engineer, team manager by day, recently became a team manager, but that's what I do by day. By night, I love to explore new dev tools, I write code, and I love to write about the tools and the code that I'm working on. I'm also very, very passionate about the developer experience. Developers these days, they tend to have to understand and interact with a large range of software components, tools, and processes. So I'm a big fan of tools that help reduce context switching and save developers time so they can focus on what they do best, which is develop and ship features. All right, so what is Backstage? So Backstage is an open source developer portal. Open source developer portal. It's developed by Spotify, and its purpose is to streamline software development and to improve the developer experience. You can host it internally, you can host it in the cloud, and there's even some third-party hosting providers that'll help you get an instance of Backstage up and running in production very quickly. So the purpose of Backstage is to help development teams. So there's a couple things that it can do to help development teams, or a couple areas that it can help development teams. So it can simplify developer tooling and workflows by pulling in information from a variety of external systems and pulling that into one spot, and including common actions that developers have to perform on those systems. So developers don't have to jump around between those different tools to do things that they do on a regular basis. It can help you standardize engineering practices. So for example, you can build software templates and have those software templates available in Backstage, and you can scaffold new solutions from those templates. So you can actually generate Git repos from templates and have like your standard tech stack implemented right off the hop. So it helps you standardize your tech stack within your organization. And finally, it can help developers to locate technical documentation. So the specific feature of Backstage I'm referring to is called Tech Docs. And it's basically a documentation as code solution. So it can pull your documentation for your components from their Git repos and render it in a nice fashion right inside of Backstage and make it searchable, and lots of other handy little features there to help make that documentation more visible within the organization. So let's take a quick tour of Backstage. So I have it running on my local machine right now, so we'll jump into it in just a second. I did want to mention that so Backstage is a two-tiered application. So there's a front end and there's a back end. It's all built in with JavaScript and running on Node.js. If you want to get it running locally on your workstation, it's actually quite simple. A couple of commands, which you can see on screen here, will get you up and running pretty quickly. So there's a Backstage create app package that'll scaffold a new instance of Backstage. You'll get prompted for a few pieces of information. The second prompt there, the selected database for the backend. So there's a couple of different database options you can choose. If you're just starting out and wanting to try it out quickly, SQLite is a good option. So that's an in-memory database that gets spun up when Backstage starts up. It allows you to kind of get up and running really quickly without having to play around with a separate database system. The one catch with SQLite solution is that when you stop your server, all your data is lost. It's just an in-memory database. So again, it's great for exploring and trying Backstage out, but if you're going to do any sort of serious development, you'll want to pick a persistent database option. Okay, so let's jump right in here. So this is a local instance of Backstage running on my machine. We're going to go through three key areas. So the first one, this home page here, this is what's referred to as the software catalog. So when you get Backstage up and running using the create app package, you'll have some sample fake data already added to the software catalog so that you can actually start to explore. So all of these items here, these components have been added to the software catalog, and I can actually click into them and view them. So the software catalog is like a collection of the components in your system that you're tracking within Backstage. And you can actually capture a bunch of information about your components. For example, you can define teams that own the components. So you always know which teams within your organization are responsible for certain components. You can classify components by their type. For example, here we got mostly services here, but there's a website down on the bottom. And you can specify your own life cycles for those components as well. And you can customize this to suit your organization's workflow. And then we can drill into an actual component. So I'm just going to jump right into the artist lookup component here. So this page here, this is the component page. The component page is where information from external systems is pulled in to capture information about that component. And you can customize this, and we're actually going to be adding a plugin later that customizes this page and adds some new tabs and some new cards to source information from GitHub directly. But basically the component page consists of a set of tabs and cards. So then the next area I want to highlight is creating components. So how do you get your components into the software catalog? So there's kind of two ways to do that. So you can go in through the create link on the side here, which takes you to this create a new component screen. And I'm going to go through the register component really quickly here first. So if you have a Git repo representing one of your components that you want to add to your software catalog, you can register it through this route. So the way that this works is Backstage will go to your Git repo. It'll actually look for a cataloginfo.yaml file. in your Git repo. That catalog info YAML file contains a set of information about your component that it uses to add your component to the catalog and categorize it and assign it to a team and so forth. I actually have a sample component open here in GitHub that I can show. So we got a backstage sample service. It's just a simple React web app. And you can see there's the catalog info YAML file here. I'm not going to go through this in depth at this point, but you can see that there's a bunch of metadata about this component that that Backstage will read in when it imports the component. To actually add this component to Backstage, it's as simple as just copying this URL and pasting it into the repository URL field here. I'm not actually going to add it just yet. We're going to come back after and add a component after we start to add a plugin to Backstage. But basically, I would just add it, analyze it, and then it'll automatically add it to the catalog. So that's the way you would get existing components into your software catalog. There's also a neat feature in here, which is this kind of the second big capability of Backstage I want to cover, which is called software templates. So if you are starting from scratch and working on a brand new component, you can actually generate your component from a software template. Out of the box, there are three built-in software templates that come with Backstage, but you can define your own software templates. There's a whole separate process for building these templates and adding them to your installation, which we're not going to be looking at today, but you can actually go through here. I'm not going to generate anything at this point, but you can go through here, create a new component. This will actually generate a Git repository, populate it. You can have it populate with a base set of code. You can use variables to inject data that's collected on the template create screen, and essentially generate your component. And at the same time, it gets added to the software catalog too. So this is a very powerful templating engine to template components. The last part that I want to cover is the tech docs section. So right now, because this is a fresh installation, I don't have any tech docs loaded in here. But if I had a component added to my software catalog that had markdown documentation within the repository, I could actually source that markdown, source that documentation and make it available right here in Backstage automatically. And you'd see it here, you'd be able to search it. I think actually I can jump in here at the end and show what this looks like once we add the Backstage sample service, because I think the Backstage sample service has some documentation. Yep, it does. So we can jump back to the tech docs and see what that looks like after at the end if we have time. So those are the three core areas of Backstage. We're going to be focusing on the software catalog and adding a plugin to extend that catalog capability. I'm going to jump back to my PowerPoint here or my slides. So let's talk about the plugin ecosystem a little bit. So the Backstage plugin ecosystem, there's about 56 or so plugins available as of today, and there's lots of plugins in development being worked on. There's two types of plugins, core plugins and marketplace plugins. The main difference there is that core plugins are primarily maintained by Spotify, and then marketplace plugins are contributed by a variety of individuals and organizations. Plugins are your way of extending Backstage to pull in information from external systems. So if I want, in the example we're going to look at today, I can go to GitHub, get a pull information about the pull requests currently opened or even closed on my Git repo and source that information and display it within Backstage directly. It's your way to extend Backstage. Let's jump right into the marketplace here. So if you go to backstageio.plugins, you can see all the plugins that are available. And as I mentioned at the top here are the four core plugins, which we actually just took a look at. So the software catalog in itself is a plugin, the software templates, tech docs, and we didn't talk about Kubernetes, but there's a Kubernetes plugin as well that's built into Backstage. And then there's a bunch of other third-party plugins that are developed by a variety of contributors, and even some of them have been developed by Spotify themselves. And there's a lot of integrations here. And the one we're going to be looking at here is this GitHub pull requests plugin. Generally speaking, these plugins, and we'll actually drill into the documentation for this specific plugin. Most of the time, the exercise or the work required to integrate a plugin into Backstage is roughly 4 to 6 steps. It is a coding exercise, so you will make some coding changes to Backstage itself in order to integrate the plugin, but it's relatively straightforward to add a plugin. There's different types of plugins as well. There's, in this case, the GitHub pull request plugin is a front-end only plugin, which means that we're only going to be making changes to part of Backstage. Some plugins have front-end components and back-end components, in which case there'll be a few extra steps for setting up the back-end. So depending on the components, not too much work to integrate these components, generally speaking. Let's jump back here. Okay, so let's go ahead and actually add the GitHub pull request plugin. So I am going to be doing this live on my machine. I do have a backup in case anything goes wrong, but hopefully everything goes smoothly. So let's open up. I have a Visual Studio Workspace open. And I'm going to kill my server, actually, because I'm going to be making some changes. I'm going to want to restart my server anyways. So let's take a quick tour of the Backstage workspace before we start to make some changes. So a couple of key areas to take a look at. So there's a top-level packages folder. So after you scaffold Backstage, this is what you end up with. This is a fresh install of or a fresh Git repo containing Backstage. So there's a top-level packages folder, and within there, the two application tiers or two tiers of Backstage are defined. So the app folder is your UI. This is the front end of Backstage. This is where we're going to be doing most of our work today with the GitHub pull request plugin. If you have backend changes, if the plugin required backend packages to be installed, then you'd be working on the backend tier as well. We won't have any changes in that component today. The other key thing to mention here is Backstage is a monorepo. So Lerna and Yarn are being used to kind of create a seamless developer experience. So when I start up my server with the Yarn dev command, it's going to build both of my tiers and deploy them to Node.js and run them locally all at the same time. So the developer experience is nice and smooth to get up and running. You don't need to be aware of too much of the complexity of what's happening right off the hop. Okay. So now that we have a quick overview of Backstage, let's take a look at the instructions. So we already started looking at the instructions for the plugin. So we're going to go through these instructions together to get the plugin integrated. And I will make note of one thing here. So this plugin, the GitHub pull request plugin, it does require a GitHub authentication provider to be configured in Backstage. I'm intentionally going to skip over this initially as we set up the plugin, because I actually want to show you what it looks like when an authentication provider hasn't been set up, what the error looks like and how we fix that. So I'm going to specifically skip over this step initially, and then we'll come back and we'll fix it. All right, so let's hop into Backstage. The first thing I'm going to launch here is an entity page. So the entity page.tsx. So you can see here, it's in our front end part of Backstage. The entity page, I'm going to scroll all the way to the bottom here. The entity page is what is used to render a variety of views in Backstage. Specifically what we just saw, the component page. So if we're dealing with components, that component page that we saw with the tabs, I don't know if I still have it open here. I don't, my server is stopped, so I won't bring it up, but the component page itself is implemented in this entity page TSX file. So this is what we're going to be modifying. So at the very top of this file here, the first thing I'm going to do is import a couple new components. And these components were, I missed a step here. Before I start making any changes here, I need to actually install the Backstage plugin, the GitHub pull requests plugin itself. So I'm going to change directories into the app directory, into the front end directory. And I'm going to use yarn to add the plugin package itself. So we're going to add the Backstage plugin GitHub pull requests package. This should only take 20 seconds or so to install. And once I add that package, then I can actually add my import statements to include the components that that package provides. Let's move it along here. And while we're waiting for that to load, I'll actually just start copying the import statements in here. We can talk a little bit about it. Okay. So we got two components here that are coming from the plugin. The first one, entity GitHub pull requests content plugin. So this is essentially going to be a new tab on the component page for components that, for the component page in Backstage. And this tab is going to contain a listing of the pull requests associated to the GitHub repo for the component. And that's what we saw in the screenshot. So that component there, essentially, I don't know if I can zoom in here. Yes, I can. That component there essentially composes this part of the screen here. So we're going to be adding this GitHub pull requests tab. And the second component that we're adding here, the entity GitHub pull requests overview card. This is a card that you can add anywhere you want on any of the tabs in the component page in Backstage, but we're going to add it to the overview tab. And it provides essentially a summary of the pull requests on your repo. So some statistics about pull requests on your repo, how quickly they're being closed and merged, and so on. So we'll see what that looks like in a second as well. So those two components. So now we actually have to add them into the code base now that we've imported them. So I'm going to just copy some code here. So we're going to jump to part of this file here that is the service entity page. So a couple of things here. Back when we were looking at the component page, I mentioned that you can classify components by their types, so services, websites. There's a couple other types as well. In this entity page, you actually have different views depending on the type of component we're looking at. So you can customize what a service looks like versus what a website looks like versus what an API looks like on the component page. So in the case of the component that we're going to be adding here, we're actually dealing with a service type component, and I'll show you where that's defined. So if I jump into the components catalog info, so we're dealing with a service type. So I'm going to be updating the service component page to show the GitHub pull request plugin. And I'm actually going to copy and paste a new route into this component. And this is coming right from the GitHub pull requests instruction page that we were looking at earlier. And what this is going to do is actually going to add a new tab. So it's going to add a new route called pull requests with the title pull request. And that'll result in a new tab being added to that component page and the tab containing the pull request content itself. And then the other part we're going to add in is the pull requests overview card. I'm going to go to a different section of this file called overview content. If I could type it properly here. Okay, so overview content. So this component is used, it's actually the same. Out of the box, you get a overview component that's used for all types of components. So it's used for services and websites and so on. So I'm going to keep it that way, and we'll just add to the overview content, and we're going to add a new item to the bottom of the grid here. That's the overview card, so that we can actually get a pull request overview on that overview tab. And that is it for now. That's as simple as it is to add the plugin. So let's start up our server. And again, just going to do a yarn dev to start up. Oops, I'm in the wrong folder here. I'm still in the app folder. I always forget to go back up to the root folder. So this will take maybe about a minute to start up roughly. And again, you can see that we're using concurrently here to start the front end and start the back end concurrently. Get it up and running on port 3000. While we're waiting for that to start up, we can kind of scan through here. So we updated the service entity page, but you can see there's a website entity page for your website components. I think actually that might be the two that come out of the box, is just the service type and the website type, but you can define other types of components as well and define their own views if you want to customize it like that.
I have a quick question. Does a Backstage component have to be an entire repo, or can it be parts of a repo?
That's a good question. So the component maps to a catalog info YAML in the repo. I don't know if it could be part of it. I think you can specify where that catalog info is found. So for example, if you wanted like a subfolder to contain a component, I think you could do that. I don't know if you could have multiple components in the Git repo though.
Okay, interesting.
Yeah, from what I've seen, it's one-to-one Git repo to component. I'm gonna close my old window here so I don't get any mix-ups. And again, so at this point, I've integrated the component, but I haven't done the GitHub authentication provider yet. So I'm fully expecting to get an authentication error when we actually try to view a component. It shouldn't be too much longer here. And the component we're going to use is the same backstage sample service. So we'll actually add this component. This Git repo has got a number of pull requests in various states. So we'll actually get to see these pull requests in backstage if everything goes as planned. Okay, so we got backstage up and running again. So I'm going to register that component. I'm going to, the URL that you use to register a component, it doesn't necessarily have to be the catalog info.yaml file. You can use the root GitHub, Git repo URL as well. It's smart enough to go in there and look for the catalog info file. Okay, so this time we're actually getting prompted to log into GitHub. So this is a good sign. So this prompt is as a result of the plugin that we just added is asking backstage for a GitHub authentication token. And since we don't have a token just yet, we're going to try and log in and we're going to see a failure here. So get a pop-up here, no auth provider registered for GitHub. So exactly what we expected. So let's go ahead and add a GitHub auth provider to backstage so that we can actually log into GitHub and complete adding the component. Close down this tab. I'm going to kill my server again. And we are going to go into the, we're actually going to take a quick look at the auth provider page for Backstage. So Backstage already out of the box integrates with a number of third-party auth authentication systems. We're going to be using GitHub in this example, but you can see from the list here that there's a number of different systems that you can integrate with to authenticate against. And this is all built into Backstage. The authentication providers for all of these systems are available. No extra NPM packages are required to integrate. So if we take a look at the GitHub authentication provider. So this is going to allow GitHub to obtain a token for the GitHub account that you want to be that you want your components to be your pull request to be pulled from. And we can actually see, I'm not going to go through this whole page here, but the authentication provider configuration is actually quite simple. It's as simple as just adding in an entry to the providers list inside of a file called appconfig.yaml. So let's hop into appconfig.yaml. So appconfig.yaml, this is your kind of main configuration file for Backstage. There's a bunch of configuration that comes out of the box here. And if we look for the providers, oh, it's right in front of me. There's a providers array here that we can add to. So out of the box, there are no providers configured. But we can add our GitHub provider. So a couple of things here. It's using system environment variables for the client ID and the client secret. So I already set these variables on my system using my own GitHub client ID and client secret. So these are already available, but you'll need to create these environment variables on your system if this is how you want to configure your authentication provider. But I'll show you how I got those values from GitHub in case you're not familiar with that. Let's jump into GitHub here. So in GitHub, for the account that you're going to be using to connect to from Backstage, if you hop into the settings for that account and you scroll down to developer settings and you go to the GitHub apps tab, here you can create a new GitHub app. And I'll just jump into, I already have a local dev server app set up here. And I'm just gonna log in. Okay. So once you create an app, you'll get a client ID, and you'll get, obviously the client secret here is hidden, but you'll get a client secret sensitive string. So these are the values that you'll want to add to your system properties. And that's the values that I've already added to the system properties. So it's going to use those credentials to connect to GitHub, to the GitHub API, get a token, and then the GitHub pull request plugin will actually be able to use that token to query for pull requests on the GitHub repo. So that is actually it. I'll save those changes and I'll restart the server here. We'll play the waiting game once more. While we're waiting for that to load, so depending on which authentication provider you're using, some plugin, depending on what plugin you're integrating into Backstage, some may have dependencies on specific authentication providers. And the instructions for each of these might vary slightly. They all ultimately result in some sort of config being added to the appconfig.yaml, but the configuration might look a little bit different for Azure versus GitHub versus GitLab and so on. But it's all pretty straightforward to configure. And of course, all the documentation is available on Backstage.io if you get stuck. All right, let's see how the server is starting up here. Looking good. So if all goes well here, we'll be able to add the Backstage sample service to the catalog and view pull requests right in Backstage. Okay, so again, because I'm using a SQLite database, the component that I just added is no longer here. I refresh the page here. So my Backstage sample service is not here because the database was reset on restart. But I'm going to re-register it. Simple enough. Grab that URL again, paste it in here, analyze it. This time I'm going to actually successfully log in. So I don't know if you would have saw that through the screen share, but the window popped up for a brief moment there. That was just Backstage connecting to GitHub to obtain the token. And that window closed without any error. So we know that the GitHub integration is working. I'm going to finish the import process here. And that's it. I have a component now in my software catalog. I can either go back to the home page and find it that way, or I can just click on this link here and it'll take me straight to the component page. And we can see the component page looks different now. It has our new pull requests tab and it has our new pull requests card. So the card and the two components we added to the entity page, they're showing up. We can see here, you know, average time of PRs until merge is 5 minutes. So some basic stats about my pull requests for the Git repo that this component is contained in. And if I flip to the pull requests tab, we can see my active pull requests. You can see closed pull requests, all of them. And you can even do a nice little handy text filter here that will actually filter on any of the columns. So for example, if I want to see any pull requests that were created 8 days ago, I can filter right in there. And I can also link directly to the pull request in GitHub. So if I need more information about that pull request, click on the link and it takes me straight to that pull request in GitHub. So with just a few lines of code and a couple commands, I was able to add a plugin here and extend Backstage to connect to GitHub. And that's pretty well it. That's a wrap.
Awesome. That was great. Does anyone have any questions? Sounds like a no. I was thinking what would be cool with that, get the auth provider plugins is if they put like a flag in there to just be like, and use this as your auth to get into the Backstage instance.
Yeah. You know what I mean? Yeah, I think you can actually do that as well. So you can pick, I don't know if it's the full set of auth providers that support that, but I think you can configure GitHub as your login mechanism for Backstage.
Oh, cool. Yeah, it's awesome. Like all the code bases I've ever worked on are not nearly large enough for this to like really benefit, but I mean, maybe. Yeah. I can see why Spotify would need it.
Yeah.
Awesome. Yeah, cool. So yeah, thanks a lot. Thanks a lot, Brian. And recording will go out shortly. We'll see you later.
Awesome. Thank you very much. Thanks for having me.
Bye.
Bye.